Hello everyone. Welcome to another episode of Fabric Tech Talk Fridays. Today I have a very special guest with me, Maraki. Maraki, do you want to introduce yourself?
Well, thanks so much for having me, first and foremost, Swetha. I really appreciate it. My name is Maraki. I'm a principal PM on the data integration team. Super excited to be here and talk you through some of the exciting things we're working on.
Wonderful. So Maraki, today I would love to dive into one of the key features that is absolutely a key differentiator for Microsoft Fabric, which is mirroring. But before we get there, I really want our viewers to understand where mirroring fits into the broader spectrum of data integration.
Yeah, I mean, I always like to start with a question, which is, what do you think is the most difficult part of getting started with any data platform, Fabric or otherwise?
It is getting your data estate in an order?
Exactly. There's so much data everywhere, right? There's data in on-premise systems, there's data in different clouds, there's data in bespoke solutions, there's data in different applications. And our customers are often having to make sense of it. Mm-hmm. And everybody needs analytics. Everybody needs data science of some sort. Mm-hmm. And everybody needs to be able to leverage AI to really kind of build out the solutions and the insights that they need, especially as the ecosystem and the industry evolves. Mm-hmm. And that's where the data integration team comes in. We make it super easy to bring all your data in, and we have a variety of ways to go about it. So the way that I like to think about it is, you have many different credit cards that you use mm-hmm. for different types of scenarios. Another kind of example that I like to use is you have multiple groceries that you sometimes will go to, right, mm-hmm. to get the food that you need. But sometimes, right, you don't need to make any stops. You just need to go from where you are to the restaurant, and you just kind of need to get on the highway and get going. And so no matter what your need is, our job on the data integration team is to give you the capabilities that you need mm-hmm. to bring data in from anywhere.
Wonderful. And you guys do a phenomenal job at it. Now, let's get to the meat of what is mirroring and why customers should really think about mirroring. What does it do for them?
Yes. So again, kind of going back to our analogies just for a moment, have you ever used Apple Pay?
Absolutely. Who doesn't use Apple Pay?
Because you don't want to keep track of all of the different cards and, walk around with a big wallet of, different cards that you're using. So just like Apple Pay, mirroring creates a reflection of the data from the source in one lake. So one lake, if we just kind of take a look at our slides, is like the OneDrive for data. Mm-hmm. So just like you use OneDrive for all of your Word docs, your PowerPoints, et cetera, we've created one lake, and I think you have a whole session on it
yes.
with Arun, I believe.
With Arun and Amir, where they really get into the weeds of what is one lake, how we even came up with that name.
Exactly. And so one lake allows you to bring all of your data together for whatever use case matters to you, right? Mm-hmm. Whether it's AI, BI, et cetera. And so mirroring is sort of like the fast track, the highway mm-hmm. to where you need to go. And so what it does is it creates a replica of your data. Mm-hmm. And as the data changes, we actually keep the mirror of that data, that replica, up to date in one lake. So imagine a row is deleted. Mm. Imagine a column is added. Imagine a column is updated, right? We keep all of that up to date in near real time so that you're not having to wait for updates, but also, right, what today in traditional ETL systems, you have to create schedules. And when you create schedules, that actually creates a significant load on the source. Mm-hmm. Because imagine you're pinging it four times a day. You're having to draw sometimes billions of rows of data four times a day, and that creates a lot of, it's a huge tax on mm-hmm. the source system. Mm-hmm. So with mirroring, we're listening for changes and making updates on the source system in near real time. And so just like you would use your Apple Pay to pay, and as things change in your account, it makes sure that it keeps track of that, right? And so it's essentially like using the physical card, but in sort of a virtual sense. So we create a replica and maintain it up to date so you can leverage it. No ETL, no refresh schedules. It's just set it and forget it.
Okay, this hits me hard. Let me tell you why. Coming from an ETL background, yeah. If you say there's no ETL, I'm like, okay, what does that mean to every ETL developer out there.
Right.
Is it going to make their job easier?
Yeah.
What does it mean for an ETL developer? When you say there's no ETL,
yeah.
What does it mean for a data engineer? What does it mean for a business user?
Yeah, so let's talk about business users first.
Mm.
So business users today are using Power BI, for example, in import mode or direct query mode.
Mm-hmm.
And there's various, you know, upsides to doing it one way or the other. With Fabric, we've introduced direct lake mode, which actually allows you to query one lake
mm-hmm.
directly.
Correct.
And in order for you to do that, the data has to be in one lake in some way, shape, or form.
Mm-hmm.
And oftentimes, getting that data into a format that is optimized for one lake can be really difficult. It requires ETL, it requires et cetera. And so if that data is ready to go, right, because you're querying it already in import mode or direct query, right, it's a gold table if we're talking about the medallion architecture,
mm-hmm.
you just kind of want a fast track that allows you to access that data and build out the reports that you need or update the ones that are using import mode or direct query to leverage direct lake mode. Does that make sense?
I get it.
Yeah.
So it's no ETL meaning you're making it really better for fast analytics.
Fast analytics, that's friction-free.
Perfect.
But if you do want to do ETL, you have the option to, right?
Absolutely.
You can leverage this mirror data in a lake house, right? You can leverage this mirror data in a pipeline and data factory,
mm-hmm.
in a data flow gen too, right? So it's like, if you need to get off the highway for a moment and pick up bread because you forgot to pick up bread in your last grocery run, you can do that, right?
Mm-hmm.
Or you can go from your starting point to your ending point. So you kind of have the flexibility that you need that allows you to build out the
Understood.
Data integration capabilities that you need.
Understood. Now, what really got my attention, Maraki, is you keep track of all the changes.
Yes.
So once I replicate the data from a mirrored, like let's say, for example, I have a source and I use mirroring, replicate the data into one lake, whatever happens on the source side, you're basically automatically keeping that data in sync in one lake for all the changes that happen on the source. Am
Precisely.
I getting it right?
Exactly.
Wonderful. But it seems too good to be true. Now, here at Fabric Tech Talk Fridays, what we like to say is, enough of all this talking.
Yeah.
Can you take us to your laptop and show us what you really got when you talk about mirroring and how all the mechanics behind it?
Yeah, we'd love to. So here are some of the things that, you know, mirroring supports today, replicates the external source, et cetera. We've kind of talked to that already. These are some of the sources that are supported today.
Mm-hmm.
Snowflake and Azure SQL DB are already in GA, and we have all of these other sources that we're supporting. So here we are in SQL Server where the on-premise data gateway has already been set up. You can see that there's data in here. We've done a select on that data. So once we jump into Fabric, we can set up the data gateway here as well. And then we can go ahead and start configuring our mirror database. So I'll go ahead and say new item, search for SQL Server. And then from here, I can create or use an existing connection. So I'll use an existing one. And once I select my table, I can go ahead and name the mirror database. And we can see that there are roughly 113,000 rows that we see flowing in. So if we quickly go into the SQL endpoint and query the data, you can see the tables there already. So now imagine we make an update to this data in SQL Server. So we go ahead and update some values, delete some values. And once you run it, you can actually start to see the changes start to flow in. So if we go ahead and write a slightly different query and add a where clause, you can actually see that updated value reflected directly from the SQL Server on-prem into OneLake so that you can now start using it for all of your analysis. And as any other updates are taking place on your SQL Server on-premise instance, those updates will also be reflected in your mirror DB as well.
That is fantastic demo. I did see all the change data capture automatically getting reflected in OneLake, Maraki.
Exactly.
Thank you for that. Now, on the slide, I do see a handful of databases or data sources that are currently supported by mirroring. Now, what if I have my data sitting in SharePoint, for example, or DB2 data source, or one of the existing SQL Server 2008, and many more?
Yeah.
What happens then?
Well, so That's a really good question. And actually, it's very much reflective of the reality that our customers face today. So if you just kind of take a look at my screen for a moment, this is the data landscape. Data spread across multiple formats, applications. Data is really everywhere. Mm-hmm. And customers, all customers, need to make sense of it, whether it's in a legacy system, right? Like SQL Server 2008, like you mentioned. Mm-hmm. And that's where open mirroring comes into play. Mm-hmm. The way I like to think about it is mirroring should be capable for anyone to bring data in from anywhere. And so with open mirroring, what we allow customers and partners to do is build their own custom mirroring solution. And in order to do that, we just ask them to load their data in a Parquet or CSV format into a one lake. Mm. And we take it all from there, convert it to Delta, along with any change data that they push up, right? If data's updated, if data's deleted, if data's inserted or upserted, and we keep it all up to date. So it empowers customers, it mm-hmm. empowers partners to build their own open mirroring solution to best fit whatever their needs are, wherever they may be on their data journey.
Perfect. This is powerful. Again, let me go back and reiterate my question. So if I have data sitting anywhere other than the supported mirroring data sources, I can leverage open mirroring as a capability to bring my data, land it into one lake, unleash the power of AI within Fabric.
Exactly, exactly. And do you want to see a quick example?
Because that's too good to be true again. I want to see a demo. Like we always say, get to your laptop, Maraki, and show us what you got
well,
in action.
I came prepared with evidence, so I'm ready to go. Okay.
Perfect.
So let's actually walk through an example for SharePoint, which is one that you actually mentioned. Mm-hmm. Let's actually walk through an example for SharePoint, which you just mentioned. Mm-hmm. So here we are in an application that I've built using C Sharp. We have a lot of different helper objects that are feeding into what I'm about to run here. The data is in SharePoint, and it has information about airlines. It has information about people. We also have some data coming in from OData. And so once I run this, what is going to happen is we're going to authenticate pretty soon here, because we got to confirm that it's actually a user that has proper privileges on the instance of Fabric that we're trying to write into. So it goes ahead and authenticates the user. And it's going to do it one more time because we're also writing data from OData. And once it does that, we can see the data starting to flow in. Here's the mirrored source that we created, and here's all of the different files that are starting to flow in from SharePoint as well as OData. So we can actually view the data in the SQL endpoint, which is really awesome. Now, let's go ahead and start making updates to the data. So I'm gonna add a 10th row for Alaska. Alaska was not originally represented in this data. I'm gonna also go ahead and make an update to an existing row. So we have American Airlines. What I'm going to do is add AA in the name so that you're not only seeing it in the title or abbreviation column. So once we go back into our code, we can rerun it. And once it reauthenticates, you can jump back into your MirrorDB and go ahead and re-query the data, and you can start to see the updated results flowing in. So we have a 10th row for Alaska, and the existing row for American Airlines has been updated to reflect AA in the name.
Perfect. This is amazing again, Maraki. So we understand what mirroring is, what are the data sources that are supported today, where open mirroring comes to play,
yes,
how partners and customers can really take advantage of open mirroring. Now, here comes my next question, which is really, really top of mind for all our customers and partners. How much does it cost?
Well, here's the good news. It's free. So oftentimes, you will get charged for the cost that it takes for us to replicate data into one lake. Mm. The replication cost is completely free. Now, there's also a storage component. Mm-hmm. Storage is free up to a certain limit. So it's a 1 terabyte per CU limit. So if you're on F64, you get 64 terabytes of storage for free for any replica, whether you're using a mirroring source that we've supported in Fabric, or you've built your own open mirroring source, or you're using one that's been built by a partner like Cluden.
That's Perfect. That is fantastic. Now, let's try to understand the pricing a little bit in detail. Maraki, again, thank you so much for demystifying it for us. So for any 1 terabyte per CU, you get the storage free. And that stays intact whether you're using open mirroring or mirroring. However, you get start to see your billing meter spin or change when you start doing downstream analytics on top of the data that you actually brought into your OneLake storage.
Yeah, exactly. So today you can use any kind of data integration capability to bring data in. Mm. Sometimes you'll get charged. With mirroring, you don't get charged for bringing the data in for your downstream workloads. You get charged when you use it in Power BI. You get charged when you use it in, in a lake house, right, for your notebooks. And it's kind of the same standard CU charges that you would expect, right? If you're using data that you're bringing in anyways.
This is absolutely powerful. Again, really appreciate all the information that you provide across mirroring, open mirroring, why customers or partners should take advantage of this. It really brings us back to meeting customers where they are in their journey. Absolutely right, Maraki, because you're not asking customers to change or stop using what they're using and switch over to Fabric in order to take the advantages of Fabric. Instead, mirroring is a capability where it truly meets the customers where they are at in their data journey.
Exactly, and I can actually give you an example. So if you take Eastman, for example, they have data that's spread across 20 different legacy systems. Mm. Same source, different legacy systems spread across the world. And they haven't really been able to consolidate that data into one system for all of their AI and BI use cases until open mirroring was introduced. So they've built an application that runs on an hourly cadence, brings all of this data together, and they're now just moving to production so that they can start building out AI solutions and BI reports for business insights.
That's phenomenal. Thank you so much, Maraki. Again, if customers or partners, if you haven't started using mirroring, you are definitely missing out on a great capability. Check out the blog that you see on the screen. Thank you, Maraki, for again co-authoring the blog with me. It really demystifies a lot of these things that we talked about today. So you can read at your own pace. Again, thank you so much for hanging out with us today.
Thanks for having me.
Thank you everyone for watching. If you found this video valuable, don't forget to hit that like button.
If this is your first time visiting the Microsoft Fabric YouTube channel, be sure to smash that subscribe button.
Drop a comment below on what you would like to see on the future episodes of Fabric Tech Talk Fridays.
That's it for today. See you all next Friday for another deep dive in the Microsoft Fabric.